Eddie. Welcome back. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. That doesn't happen often, but when it does, it's like. Morning. Good morning. So good to see each and every one of you. We welcome you this morning. We welcome each other, and it is so good to be in God's house worshiping with one another. And we welcome those of you who are visiting with us online, and we come together to worship the God who is worthy of our adoration and our worship. And so welcome and good morning. A number of things that I would like to bring to your attention is that we have Vacation Bible School coming up this coming Saturday from 9 o'clock until 2 o'clock p.m. And everything is geared up. You see some of the wonderful images and decorations for Vacation Bible School as we come into worship this morning. And so the theme is getting back to the Bible. And that's something we all seek to do. That's exactly right. So we lift them up. We lift up this wonderful ministry of outreach to our children. We're continuing the effort for the Back to School Bash and collecting shoes, so I want to remind everyone of that. And I think that just about covers everything, and Alan has an announcement or something to inform us this morning, and so I'm going to turn it over to him. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Good to see you.
Morning, and happy Father's Day to all the fathers. One quick one that I hadn't talked to Koki about, the blood drive. We did have a blood drive that was fairly successful, 17 pints of blood. And the good news from that most of you will be glad to hear is that we no longer have to move the chairs anymore for the blood drive. We've arranged they can use the back area, so we no longer have to do that. So that's the good news there. The other news is, I know many of you have asked who was going to be taking over the pulpit after disaffiliation, which we still have planned. Hopefully everything will be done next week. Thanks to Kyle's committee and work, we have reached an agreement where H.L. Talbert, who most of y'all know, will be taking over the pulpit. Unfortunately, he couldn't be here with us today. He had some other duties, but he will be here next week as a visitor, and then the following Sunday as a pastor. So hopefully, I hope all y'all will welcome him and thank him for stepping up and taking over the pulpit. That's all. Thank you.
All right, Alan. Thank you.
And thank you and congratulations. You as a congregation and I as a minister embark in new chapters in our lives, and Godspeed to each and every one. And may God's blessings be upon you and HL and the ministries of God and the ministries of Christ among us. But it's not over till it's over, right? So I've got one more Sunday. So I'll enjoy that. We'll enjoy that together until that comes. I'm convinced that if someone did not tell me I had to stop, I would never stop. You know, there's just, someone said retirement is not a Christian concept. Think about that. How can you retire from serving God? That's exactly right. It is not a Christian concept. And so we never retire from our relationship with God and serving Him till we breathe our last breath. And I've held the hand of so many people who did breathe their last breath. I was with them when they breathed their last breath many occasions. And they lived their lives until they breathed their last breath loving God and serving Him. That's pretty powerful. So, Godspeed. Now I just want to take a little time here because the opening prayer and the call to worship have much to do with Father's Day. And what a privilege it is. It's not a right, it's a privilege to be a father. It's a tremendous privilege, and it's a great responsibility. And without the grace of God, it's difficult to manage. To take on the responsibilities of caring for a family and caring for children. And Jesus would tell us that there is nothing more important in life than children. And guess what? We're all children. We're all children. I'm still wondering what I'm going to do when I grow up. You know, there's that element of playfulness, imagination, and joy, and the child that's in each and every one of us. But getting back to Jesus, He especially loved the little children. And what a privilege it is to have them and to be able to be with them. I can remember the greatest transformation in my heart was when I had a child. And in ministry, the very first one, I was in seminary. I was anxious. I was worried about how things would be. Then my first son, Christopher, was born. And it didn't happen right at the hospital, but we brought him home in that little apartment there in Atlanta, Georgia, in Stone Mountain, which took forever to get to Emory University in that drive there. And one night, after the night we brought him home, I went over to his crib and just listened to him breathe. I just listened to him breathe. And later on, he would chatter, you see. But I just listened to him breathe. And there was a peace that came over me that I'd never had before. And that peace has been with me to this day. And from there, I was not anxious about any other thing, and I knew that life would work out. And it has. I've been so blessed, as you have been so blessed. I just wish we had time to hear each other's stories. But many of you have been fathers to children, and some of you have not been able to have children. And this is a day that we grieve with you, especially if you wanted children. Some people do not want children, and we respect that, but some people really do want children. And I've been with people who really wanted children, and they were hugely disappointed that they could not have children, and so we grieve for them. But they, too, became fathers and mothers to children not their own. And many of you have been like a father to others who were children not your own. As we talked about, mothers have been on Mother's Day. And so what a privilege. I remember Jim Calabrese and the Statesville Senior High Grenadier Band. I remember my Sunday school teachers. Of course, I remember my father, and I mourn his death. I remember his friends who were mentors to me. You remember your parents' friends, their fathers, fathers who mentored you along the way and cared for you. And so we celebrate on this day Father's Day. But there's one Father that we celebrate most of all, and that's our Heavenly Father. Because without Him, life ceased to exist. Without Him, there is no continuity. Without Him, all our efforts are in vain because there is a definite end. I mean, life would just end. But praise be to God that we will be together with our fathers and our fathers and our forefathers. Our great-grandfathers, I didn't even know my great-grandfather. Did any of you? Some of you probably did. Raise your hand if you knew your great-grandfather. Well, see, many of us didn't. But we will see them because of our Heavenly Father. And our Heavenly Father is a father to us even if we had no father. And we mourn that too for children who did not have a father. So Father's Day is not like a syrupy sweet Hallmark card. It's complicated. It's difficult. And yet God is with us in the difficulty. Even when we did not have a father, we pray for those who did not have one that God Himself became the father or that God provided that through someone else. So we celebrate Father's Day. And as we do that, we stand together to sing the call to worship. And then we will pray a prayer for all fathers. Let's all stand. Let's join together in this prayer on Father's Day in unison. Gracious God, we praise you for our fathers and all those who have been like a father to us, who exemplified divine qualities like faith, hope, and love. We thank you for those who kept fear astern and hope at the bow, who believed life to be more benevolent than not, persevering through darkness, trusting your light, leading by example, showing us a better way, that we might know true joy. Thank you for fathers who helped us achieve dreams, though beyond reach. For fathers who failed us, may you work in our lives for our healing and theirs, so we might be freed to know a greater joy in you as the one true Father of us all. We also ask you for all men who were like a father to us, who took our hand and heart and guided us along the way. Gracious God, protect and defend our fathers and all men that they may grow in strength and stature. Offer our fathers comfort in times of trial, confirmation in opposition, forgiveness in times of failure, and endow them with wisdom, patience, strength, grace, and understanding, so that their hearts are like your own. May your blessings be upon all men who are fathers or who have been like a father to us. Amen. Now please remain standing for the opening song. The Lord's Prayer, it is yours. It's yours.
Father, let your kingdom come. Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Father, let your kingdom come. Father, Father, let your will be done on earth as in heaven, right here in my heart. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us as we forgive the ones who sinned against us. Forgive them and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from.
Be seated. Unless, of course, you'd like to stand. Should always include that, should we? Be a long time standing, maybe. So, yes, now we have time for the children. And Cindy's going to just go straight to them. What's that? Yeah, okay. Good morning. Good morning. So good to see you. Yes, there is more over there. That's okay. of our gifts to Almighty God and ask the ushers to come at this time.
Traveling through this world below, but there's no sickness, toil, or danger in that bright land to which I go. My body rests beneath the side. I'll drop this cross of self-denial and go singing on God. 'Cause I'm going there to meet my Savior, to live with Him no more to roam. I'm only going over Jordan. I'm just going.
Gracious God, thank you for the gift of music, the gift of life, the gift of song, the gift of children, the gift of each other. What a sacred, sacred and holy place we stand in. And even when we are in the world, it is sacred because of you. And so, Lord, we offer ourselves and these gifts as a means of offering hope, ministry, empowerment, and joy to others. And may your blessings be upon them in the name of your dear Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Now we have Children's Church and Donna. And thank you for your faithful ministry to our children, Donna. Appreciate that so much. They're just running to get over there and to be a part. It's at this time in our service that we turn to our God in prayer. I just want to say a word of gratitude for Cindy Steichleather and the joy of her heart and her music that she brings us every single Sunday. And Cindy, we're privileged to have you. And our choir, we thank you too for just bringing wonderful music every Sunday. There's a lot of work that goes on behind the scenes, and there's a lot of fun and a lot of humor, and but there's a lot of preparation, and we just thank you this morning. Yeah, we are grateful. Well, I know that you noticed that Linda's not with us this morning, and she was traveling, and she developed sepsis due to an infection, and she stopped over in Georgia. And now she's at Iredell Memorial Hospital, and she was really sick. Her electrolytes got out of whack. And I tell you, as a minister, I never realized how serious it can be for people whose electrolytes get out of whack. And she was really, really in a tough place. And it was so good to see her smiling on Saturday. I really appreciate the prayers that went out, Cindy and Sarette, and your ministry to us. And also that of Teresa Tucker is, no? Saunders. Teresa Saunders, thank you. It was coming. It's the way the brain is sometimes. And I tell you what, through the years, I think I've had over 1,500 people to get to know, plus people in the community. So sometimes it just sort of runs together. But Teresa Saunders, yes, thank you. Gosh, more than 1,500. So anyway, Linda, she was smiling yesterday and just so grateful, and her, the love of her life, Ron was with her, cheering her on, and Linda said, she said, you know, they are so wonderful here, but you know why that is with Linda? Because she's so wonderful. And so only naturally people are wonderful to her because she's just so wonderful. And she's easy to love. So we're just grateful she's doing okay. We continue to lift up all the other people who have been named before us in the past. And they are Brenda Walker, Ruby Beatty, Amaya Sharp, Henry Williams, Helen Combs, Nancy Harris, Jim Taylor, Billy Swaim, Leonard Brown, and Jeff Fulk. And the Canadian fires continue. We lift up that concern in our world. And we also lift up other concerns among us as a people. We made it through some things recently, and we're all grateful for that. And I don't know, things are looking pretty good, actually, in terms of numbers. And I'm always glad to see when the stock market's doing well. So at any rate, some good things at least happening. Never, never, never is it going to be perfect, but we are so blessed, really. We're really so blessed that things work as well as they do, considering there's 6.7 billion or so of us on this planet. And we lift up other nations and other countries. Those concerns that you would like to express by raising of hands this morning, any concerns that you have? Okay, let's go to God together in prayer then. Oh, gracious God, you are King of kings and Lord of lords, mighty God, mighty counselor. We find our rest in you. If we're willing to rest and be with you, if we're willing to take time out of our schedules and to read your word, to immerse ourselves in that word that you've given us, and even more so, just to spend time with you and be with you in the living word, which was your Son, Jesus Christ, through the power of your Holy Spirit. And we thank you for this most precious gift, the gift of your Holy Spirit, who abides with us, whom you said will not leave us as orphans, whom you said will lead us into all truth, who will give us that which we need to say at the time we need to say it, who said, "These things that I do, you will do also, and even greater things will you do, because I go to my Father on your behalf." So right now, as we pray together, you go to your Father, our Father, on our behalf. How grateful we are for the power of your Holy Spirit, the power of your Spirit that was present in creation, the power of your Spirit that parted seas and provided manna, the power of your Spirit that was, the Ark of the Covenant was a perfect conduit of that power, and on through the prophets, priests, and kings, and then culminating your Son, Jesus Christ, upon that day when he was baptized in the River Jordan, and you said, you spoke, "This is my Son in whom I'm well pleased," and the Spirit descending upon him as a dove, he received your Spirit, he received your power, and on many occasions he healed, he delivered, he proclaimed, and set free. For he came to release the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, the lame walk, and the favorable year of the Lord, which was indicative of restoration and balance, being the scales being reset so that one's debts are forgiven. And we thank you for this favorable year that is proclaimed to us each and every day. Oh God, we lift up each person who's been named before you, and we ask you to bless them by the power and grace of your Holy Spirit. Be present with Linda. She's usually present here with us. And if not, she's present in our hearts, just as many people who may not be here, but they are present in our hearts as well. We love them, miss them, and pray for safe travels if they're vacationing or if they're traveling on Father's Day. And all those who are traveling, we ask you to bless and to give safe travel. But oh God, may you bless Linda and bring healing to her. We lift her up along with many others here and ask your healing hand to be upon them. And Lord, we lift up all nations. We realize that as a country, we are not the only country. It's a matter of working together so that every nation is great, because when every nation lives in your will, then every nation will be great. But it behooves those of us who belong to you to encourage our own nation and other nations of the goodness of Almighty God, which is you. That we should tap our energies and hook our wagon to you, to hitch our wagon to you, to follow you, and to encourage others to do the same. And to be so radically in love with you and then the world that you love, that people see our love for them above everything else. The care of creation and stewardship. And so, O God, we lift up the nations, the healing of nations, and we thank you for every bit of well-being that we do have. And we thank you for the opportunity to provide better ways each and every day. And, oh God, we ask you to diminish and eradicate these wildfires that are doing so much damage. And, of course, nature will replenish itself. But we ask you to be with those who are firefighters and EMS and those who have been sent, and just ask you to abate these wildfires that are doing so much damage. And, oh God, to, in this way, provide the air that we breathe. For do we not breathe in your Spirit? And do we not drink water that reminds us of living water? Do we not eat bread that reminds us of the bread of Jesus? And do we not breathe in the air around us, which is like breathing in your Holy Spirit? And so, Lord, all of these things we look to you for the well-being of our world in which we live. And we now pray that prayer that Jesus himself taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen and amen. Our text is from Luke 14, 25 through 35, and we are going to be talking about Christ's call to discipleship. Christ's call to discipleship is to count the cost. So from our text we read, large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. And anyone who does not carry his cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has had enough money to complete it? For if he lays the foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you who does not give up everything he has cannot be my disciple. Salt is good, but it loses its saltiness. How can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile. It is thrown out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. And this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So Christ's call to discipleship is to count the cost. I read this story recently about a fellow named Bob. And Bob was single, and he lived with his father, and he had a family business. He ran it with his father, and it was a lucrative business. They did very well together. Well, when it became apparent that his father would not live much longer and that he would inherit quite a fortune, Bob decided it was time to settle down to find a lovely wife with whom to share his soon-to-be abundant wealth. So one evening in an investment meeting, he saw the most beautiful woman he had ever seen in his life. Her natural beauty just took his breath away. So he went over to her and said, I may look like an ordinary guy, but unfortunately, my father's not well. He's not expected to live much longer. And in a few years, I will inherit $10 million. And I would just love to get to know you. So she said, well, I tell you what, give me your business card. So he does. Then just 3 days later, this woman became Bob's stepmother. That's right. That's right. She married Bob's father, and she became the heir of the $10 million and the family business. So what does this teach us? It's not exactly what Bob planned. It is not what he expected. So unbridled enthusiasm must be tempered with reason. We must count the cost. We must count that. There's a story of a woman who attended worship, and up until her early adult years, in churches that gave a lot of emphasis to the freedom of emotional expression, free expression of one's emotions. And eventually she realized this did not sustain her, and she needed something more to offer balance to her life. So she began engaging in worship that offered more in terms of thoughts, ideas, reason, to accomplish this very thing. She still had an abiding love of Jesus, but now she found a way to express it in a different way. So our text is similar in these ways, that it cautions us against unbridled enthusiasm, which can become hysteria or hysterical. So let's take a look. There were many who were starting to follow Jesus. There were many who heard about Jesus. And so of those who were making the decision to follow him, did they really know what they were getting into? Did they really understand what it meant when he talked about the cost of following him? And so he teaches these words this morning. Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it? It's obvious that Jesus learned many wonderful lessons from his heavenly Father, himself a builder. Many details must be considered. Or suppose a king is about to go to war against another king. Won't he first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to go up against 20,000? And won't he send a delegation long before they've even made it very far at all? Headed off at the pass, be wise, diplomatic, and smart. So Jesus is speaking in practical terms about discipleship. If we want to follow Christ and be his disciple, we must count the cost. We must count the cost of being a disciple of Jesus Christ. In Effective Planning, Stephen Covey, in the Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, he suggests that we begin with the end of our lives in mind. Not where we want to be right now, not where we want to be in 2 or 5 years, but where we want to be at the end of our lives. If we were to die tomorrow, what legacy would we leave behind? How do we want to be remembered? Then the question becomes, is what we have given ourselves over to really worth it? If we want to serve a larger and higher purpose, to pass on saving grace and divine principles onto others, how are we going to do that? If we want most of all to pass on the things of God, if we want most of all to serve Christ, if we want most of all to share divine truths, then how are we going to do that? Author and business guru Peter Drucker says his life was shaped by a teacher who once asked, God bless teachers. This teacher asked this class, what do you want to be remembered for? Drucker was only 13 years old when this teacher asked him what he wanted to be remembered for. But we underestimate children. Drucker still remembers this. He was 13, and look where he is today. A 13-year-old in class where a teacher says, what do you want to be remembered for? And when he heard the question, he didn't have an answer. But his teacher said in the class, I didn't expect you to be able to respond, the teacher continued. But if you still can't answer this question by the time you're 50, you will have wasted your life. That was a wise teacher. Up until 2019, the baby boomers were the largest generation in the United States. Boomers belonged to the generation born between 1946 and 1964. Millennials are now the largest, born between 1981 and 1996. And there are 72.1 million of them. Boomers are now taking a demographic backseat to new trends being set by millennials and younger generations. And you can't help but notice it in so many different ways. From the commercials we see on television, to the books, to things that are being sold, to the way clothes and clothing are being designed, it's a new world for many of us who are older. It's a lot of adapting for us. Boomers are also facing another trend, their own mortality. We're dying. We're dying. We're older. We're dying. In just 3 years, from 2013 to 2016, an average of 1.33 million boomers died per year, or 5% of the boomer population. 10,000 boomers turned 65 every single day. 10,000 turned 65 every single day, which is one every 8.7 seconds. This is why millennials surpassed boomers back in 2019. And there's nothing that humbles one more than the subject of our mortality. Many boomers are looking back over life and experiencing remorse, contrition, and feeling repentant, wondering what could have been done differently and much, much better. Facing death has a way of doing that. Phil Munsey, in his book Legacy Now, made an important observation. When the youngest of the boomers were turning 50, the boomers were making a radical departure from the gotta have the best, serve me, consumerist mentality. And this shift was significant because boomers have been shifting from a me to we, from a take to give, and a more is more to a less is more mentality. And we've seen that among the boomers now. And with such thoughts of mortality, there are accompanying thoughts regarding the possibility of life beyond this one. One must certainly count the cost here. It is very likely there is a God. It is very likely that Jesus lived, died, and rose again. There's history there. There were disciples. His own mother did not refute his resurrection. And there's one person you ain't going to lie to, and that's your mama. Mary never refuted Jesus' resurrection. And the disciples gave their life to this new cause. It was not a hoax. It was very likely that there is more beyond this life. It is very important that we set ourselves in this direction, in the direction of hope in God. Also, the greatest testimony regarding life beyond this one is this life right now. You're alive. And that is the greatest testimony of the life that is to come. This life speaks boldly and resoundingly. As Paul so eloquently stated in the beginning of Romans, all creation and all that exists bears witness to the existence of God. All that we see in creation stirs faith. Faith also opens the door to a greater understanding of the world and a greater understanding that what we call mystery is increasingly explained and given meaning by our exploration of what surrounds us through science and biology and chemistry. You've heard me say it before. When we delve into those things that God has done, we are just discovering in science and in mathematics and in medicine the fingerprints of our Heavenly Father as He worked all these things out in creation. So that when a miracle happens beyond our comprehension, there is both a God, divine reason, and a very real explanation. Long before us, God knew matter. God knew antimatter, black holes, the ability to transcend time in a parallel universe, or even go back in time, and that there are mathematical equations to explain everything from music to the ever-expanding galaxy. And we are those who are just coming to grips with these many mysteries around us. God works in such a way that God works within the framework of the laws and the principles of the universe without being limited by those laws or those principles so that all things become possible. You heard me talk last week about that quantum physics, that though an object may appear solid, it's actually more space than it is solid. And there in the atoms and the neutrons and electrons, there's this energy field. And this means that they can change at any time. Those electrons and protons and neutrons can change for the better or the worse at any time. It depends on what influences them. And God says, Word says, God calls things that are not as though they were. And faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. So how is it that all of a sudden a person who has cancer is completely healed? That story I told you about Kevin Lester's father. The next day they called that the miracle. They called that the miracle at Carolina's Medical Center because he was completely well and had a full recovery when it was impossible. And so Jesus used the ground and spit. He used objects. He used things to stir faith, things of this world. So there's an association between matter and creation and the ability of cells to heal by the power of God simply because of this quantum field and this all of that. And if you don't buy that, then please understand that what I'm talking about are miracles. And further, it isn't a generational thing to talk about mortality. It is a human thing. It is practically impossible to think about existence and our mortality without also thinking about God. And what more wonderful place to think about mortality and existence than in this sanctuary, in this place of worship? This is the most sacred and safest place that we could possibly be thinking about God. So Christ says, "Follow me," offers us the great hope of everlasting life, to live a purposeful and meaningful life, and we do well to hitch our wagon to that star. German psychologist Erik Erikson describes an important stage of human development as generativity versus stagnation. Generativity is the stage of human development when one becomes aware of the need to live beyond oneself and begin the task of leading a meaningful, purposeful, and useful life. And Abraham Maslow spoke of it as self-actualization. And Jesus spoke of it as abundant life. Generativity versus stagnation. To come to a point in life that we realize that we are to live beyond ourselves and lead a meaningful and purposeful life. In 1962, the woman who was the first woman to serve in the United States Congress, Clare Boothe Luce, offered President John F. Kennedy these words of wisdom. She said, "A great man," she told him, "is a sentence. A great man is a sentence." She said, Abraham Lincoln's sentence was, "He preserved the Union and freed the slaves." Franklin Roosevelt's sentence was, "He lifted us out of the Great Depression and helped us win a world war." But Luce was telling Kennedy this because she said, "You are so scattered in trying to accomplish so many tasks that you have no focus." And she said, "I'm concerned that your life will not be a sentence, but a muddled paragraph." Sometimes, even no matter who we are, presidents or preachers or CEOs or fathers or mothers, need a check to whether or not we're putting the things that are most important the most important. I'll never forget serving one church that was in a quiet neighborhood, and it kind of ended in a dead end road. And the church had a playground, and children in the neighborhood would come and play. So one time I was out in the cemetery, and the cemetery and the playground were pretty close together. And this little boy came up to me, and he looked at the church like a little boy, if I was out in the parking lot, look at this church. And he says, what was the first question he asked me? He said, "Do you own that?" He looked at this big church and asked me if I owned it. And I said, "Oh, no. It belongs to God." I said, there are even congregants who think they own it, but they don't. It belongs to God. There are people who think they own it, but it belongs to God. That belongs to God. So this little boy then asked me, well, how much does it cost? Does it cost anything to go there? And I said, no, it's absolutely free. You don't have to do anything. But it costs you everything. It costs you your life. Jesus said, those of you who do not give up everything for my sake cannot be my disciple. Boy, that's sobering. That is sobering. Those who do not give up everything for my sake cannot be my disciple. So here's some words from a fellow sojourner of Christ, and I have written this, and I am the fellow sojourner. But this is my discussion with Almighty God in relation to Jesus' words here about that I must hate father and mother, brother and sister, even my own life, and follow Him. Everything? Really? How can you possibly mean everything? How can you possibly mean that? You mean my hopes, my dreams, my goals, my aspirations, my success, my joy? Do you mean my pain, my resentment, my loneliness, my spite, my bitterness? Do you? Do you mean my life's work, my education, my degrees, my life experiences, which are rich and valuable to me and those who know me, my value, my worth, and my dignity? All these things I take great pride in. Do you mean all that too? Everything? And do I give you the insult and injury of those who insult these very foundations of my existence? Dare I be laid bare for you, even to suffer the indignity of others who speak against me? At least the world values and even merits its own, and you expect me to store up treasure into heaven? What if there is no heaven? What then? Well, I have been given my life to nothing more than an opiate of the masses or an illusion of the soul. Do you mean God, all that I love and all that I hold dear? And then comes the still small voice. You know the answer. You know the answer. Four words. Yes. It costs everything. And Jesus said, the one who seeks his own life will lose it, and the one who loses his life for my sake will find it. And if our lives were to be summed up by a sentence, I think there is one superior to them all. And it is not the words of a mere mortal, but the words of the one who is eternal. Only this one can speak such words, and they are only seven words, seven being the significant sign of completion. And that will be, well done, well done, well done, thou good and faithful servant. That's where it all rests, is in what God says. Amen. The cost of discipleship is to count the cost and to weigh that, and if we need to make an adjustment, then we need to make that adjustment. And it is so important that we look at the end result of what we think and what we put into practice and what we enforce as to whether or not what we do supports the kingdom of God. Everything should be weighed by that. Does it support the kingdom of God? Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is there in heaven. Amen. So let's stand for the benediction. Happy Father's Day. Hope you have a great lunch. Godspeed to each and every one of you. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so may the Lord cause righteousness and praise to spring forth before all the nations. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.